And I'll see you in the next video where we talk about how this spirit of anti-imperialist resistance actually continued. It wasn't just the first church. I've continued to follow the stream all the way up until now that has continued since then. So in my last video, and you should probably go watch that for more context, it's in the link in the description, but in there, as you remember, I talked about the birth of Christianity, talking about how it started as this alternative to Roman imperialism. And of course, as we said, the Roman Empire said things like Caesar, the son of God and the savior of the world, is bringing a universal reign of peace and prosperity, and there is no other name by which one can be saved than that of Caesar. And Caesar was going around the world making peace through military victory. And then Christians said, actually, Jesus, we believe, is the Son of God, is the Savior of the world, bringing a reign of peace and prosperity, but peace through sacrificial love. And they took care of one another, provided for one another, took care of their own poor and non-Christian poor. And this continued, because when you think of like what Christianity is, of everything it's been in history and everything it is today, you may immediately just think of imperialist Christianity, of colonizing Christianity, a very violent Christianity that looks way more like Caesar than it does Jesus. But the anti-imperialist stream continued as well. And think about this. If Christianity was just a colonizing religion, then Christianity would have disappeared with the first empire that used it to colonize. But it continued beyond the empires that used it to colonize because it was also used by the people who fought the colonizers, by the people who inspired others to rise up against imperialism. That's how it always has worked. And when I say I'm a Christian, and when I talk about Christianity, I'm talking about this stream of anti-imperialist Christianity. I think of people like Saint Benedict of Nursia, who, after Christianity was no longer illegal and you were killed for being a Christian, it became adopted by the Roman Empire, and therefore it became safe, and therefore it became something else, and Benedict left the church, went and lived in the desert, and started his own different kind of Christian community that lived in the desert, committed to poverty and helping people from below instead of being a part of this church that was all about getting above. And that's where this movement of the desert fathers and mothers began. I also think of Saint Francis of Assisi, my favorite saint, also plenty of people's favorite saint because of how he lived. And he, his entire life, birth to death, was during the Crusades. And during that, he chose an alternative lifestyle, committed his life to serving the poor and sick, and started a whole order called the Lesser Brothers, who were committed to the same things. And he even tried his best to stop the Crusades, even. I also think of Dietrich Bonhoeffer and the Confessing Church in Nazi Germany, who through their church were an active resistance to Hitler and the Reich Church. And he ultimately was imprisoned and then killed for joining the resistance in a plot to kill Hitler. I think of Spanish conquistadors who used the image of the Virgin of Guadalupe and probably fictional miracles about the Virgin of Guadalupe in order to convert indigenous people and mestizos to Christianity. And of course, ultimately through that, to get them to be more subservient. That's colonizing Christianity, of course, but the people ended up embracing the Virgin of Guadalupe, and over the centuries, her skin color and the images got darker and darker and darker, looking less like the Spanish conquistadors and more like the people that they oppressed using that image. Then the Virgin of Guadalupe was used during several rebellions during multiple Mexican revolutions, carrying her image on a banner as they battled oligarchs for land and liberty. They used it to oppress them, and then they dug deeper into this spirituality that they used to keep them subservient and realized, actually, this stuff, this God, this Bible, this entire ideology is on our side. Perhaps an even clearer image of this is Nat Turner, the famous African slave who led a rebellion against slave masters. But before that rebellion, he was a preacher, and they took him to these different plantations to preach the verses about being obedient to your masters. Those verses are in there, and slave masters kept using those verses, even taking them out of context and using them to say way worse things than what the Bible actually says. But at the same time, within the Bible, there are plenty of verses against slavery. So to hand slaves the Bible as a way of keeping them subservient is a terrible idea, because if they actually read it, then they're going to use it to rebel against you. Duh. One of my favorite scenes from the remake of The Birth of a Nation is when Nat Turner gets in trouble for baptizing a white man, and he is being rebuked by this white preacher, and then they end up going back and forth with Bible verses. Watch this clip.
Boy, you'd better say something, and quick.
Take heed, therefore, unto yourselves, and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers, to feed the church of God which he has purchased with his own blood.
Exhort servants to be obedient to their own masters and to please them well in all things, not answering
you
again.
You are bought with a price. Do not become slaves of men.
He that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger.
Beware of false prophets who come dressed in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravening wolves.
You black bastard!
Nah. He that stealeth the man and selleth
don't
him,
you
or if he be
me,
found
black.
In his hand, he shall surely be put to death.
The way Nat Turner is using the Bible in that scene is how I use the Bible still today, and I condemn every Christian who has ever used the Bible in the way of that slave master. And this isn't about interpreting the Bible however you want, making it what you want it to say, as conservatives accuse me of. No, it is about actually looking at the core of this tradition and realizing this was always an anti-imperialist movement. From the very beginning, anti-imperialist, anti-fascist, anti-colonization. This distinction is what Cornel West calls the difference between Constantinian Christianity and prophetic Christianity, or what I would call the difference between clanging cymbal Christianity and the baseline of Christianity. That's influenced by 1 Corinthians 13, where Paul says, "If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing." And so the ones who want to spread this thing through colonization and through oppression are the clanging cymbal, because they do not have love. And the ones who want to actually use this tradition in order to love people better and in order to love more and more and more people and love beyond ourselves through the communities we make with this stuff, that is the baseline of Christianity that has always continued to exist since the beginning. Or what some people may refer to as the difference between taking the Great Commission, which says, go out into the world and make disciples of all nations, and ignoring the Great Commandment, which says to love your neighbor as yourself. We, of course, know plenty of stories of Christians who were all about the Great Commission but ignored the Great Commandment. Well, I'm on the side of the Great Commandment. And if we actually love people right, we see when people do that, especially if we read about it in the book of Acts, the first church, that is how disciples are made, because people want to be a part of a movement that loves people better. And at the same time, I'm obviously on the side of other people who are on the side of love and loving people better and anti-imperialism and colonization, whether they're a Christian or not, because I believe we're following this same path with the same goals. And if Christians actually lived this out like they should, then they would actually never ever have to worry about the issue of religious freedom. No one would be threatening to take away any rights of any Christians to do or say whatever they want if they were actually serving the world like their Jesus told them to. Let me end this by reading this quote from Divine Disobedience: Profiles in Catholic Radicalism, in this chapter where the author visits Emmaus House and the leaders there, who are against the injustices of the Catholic Church but still consider themselves very Catholic. One of the leaders, David Kirk, in 1968 said, "I think the Catholics must and will evolve toward that kind of pluralism to stay united. However, to work toward that unity, many of us had to drop out of the self-worshipping institution outside the Roman complex, and that's what I've done." And the interviewer says, "I thought you were against dropping out." And then he said, "I do not in the least consider myself a dropout of the church. I only said I've dropped out of the self-worshipping Roman complex. I consider myself at the very core of the church, attempting to recapture its original meaning. A lot of bishops and cardinals are on the fringes of the church. We're in dead center." And that applies to all of Christianity. I'm not talking about Catholicism here. And that's how I feel. Through this work and the stuff I'm saying, several Christians consider me heretical and outside of orthodoxy, outside of the church, whatever. I very much see myself as dead center. And I appreciate everyone else who has come across these videos and feel the same, whether they're Christian or not. So that's what I'm talking about when I talk about Christianity. You feel me? Good. Leave a comment. Let me know some of your thoughts on this stuff. Of course, subscribe for more videos like this. Also, if you want to show your support, I would greatly, greatly, greatly appreciate it if you supported me on my Patreon, patreon.com/DamonGarcia. And thank you to my patrons. Let me list some of them now. Karen in Colorado, Ranger Jenny, Refined Your Scene, Jacob McCarthy, Jack and Theory Plebe, and Mike Lodato. I love you all. Thank you so much for your support. So join them. Don't you want to join the squad? Thank you all. I appreciate you. See you in the next video. Bye-bye.